structure that I gave you, it gave you basically the is noise. So just fundamental concepts about the flow control. What is active flow control? What is the closed loop control? And as I said, majority are active flow control. And how from basic research to all the way implementation in the real product. So it is very easy reading. So in case something is missing, you can go over that. But also it will help you in if you are looking at some research papers. It will make it easier to understand that. So the way the whole thing has been structured, you know, what you have notes is that lectures are all focusing on basic concepts and the tutorials are some applications. So that is structured actually, but it's not completely compartmentalized in that way. So this is a tutorial number 2. So this is actually more oriented towards all of you, because it's basically the application of CFD. And as I told you, and please remember that everything that I will show you, there is an experimental component, because CFD you have to validate it. So this is based on the work actually of again my student. His name is Matthew Lakebrink, and it was a work that he did for a master's thesis using CFD, and now he is working in Boeing St. Louis. So it is really directly relevant because it can be done in a place like any institution, including here. So it will focus is that what is the experiment and what you are trying to do and what you are learning out of it. So I will not spend too much time on every slide, because the explanation required is not that much, you know, we have already talked about it. But when I talk about lecture 3, the goal will be to give you some new concepts or new ideas. So that is how it is structured, okay. So this I'm going to talk about, that there are some experimental work and there is CFD simulation together, okay. So I will not show you any CFD simulation which doesn't have an experimental component, okay. And I will show you what I have talked about, that you have a synthetic jet and you have a micro ramp. And the idea was that how do you have all these two together, which we talked about, and then how you can optimize it. So optimization part, that how do you place these and how do you put the synthetic jet, is quite complicated actually, as I tell, too many parameters. So I originally was trying to go through the optimization theory, but I thought that that will totally make it a big difficulty. So I took those slides away. Now this is one of the few cases that I got involved in the experiment. So there are actually 2 or 3 cases that I was involved in the experiment. Most of them I was not. So only CFD. So what I'm going to show you also some experiment which can be done in any place, like at this institution or other places, and these are small scale experiments, not very expensive, but they are very useful. Okay. So I will also highlight that what are the issues even you are trying to set up experiment. But I must confess ahead of time that I am not an experimentalist, so my depth of knowledge in experiment is relatively not as good as in CFD. So let's see. So this is the thing that we designed actually. Not we means that this student Lakebrink, with the help of some technicians, we designed this wind tunnel. And as usual, you know, people in academia know somebody has to pay for it. And so we got some support again from Boeing. So what you have is a small kind of a wind tunnel kind of a section. So you have inflow, outflow, and you have a test section. So this is, if you remember, you know, most of the wind tunnels are, it is a subsonic flow, So they are converging and diverging nozzles, and then you have a little area for the, and this is transparent, so you can see what is happening and you can have a flow visualization. And since it is a modern time, so you can use PIV, particle image velocimetry, or laser Doppler velocimetry. So the one that was used here was PIV. It's very cheap to buy it, but so nobody uses hot wire or of course pitot tube is gone long time ago. So what you see here now, you can see that how small these dimensions are. So only, you know, half a foot. So it was a very small plexiglass base, very inexpensive. And we have technicians who can do a very good job. So it was designed and done, and it could all be done in a matter of, with the help of, it was already built and ready to go in a matter of 2 months. And it can be done here in 2 months also, I can guarantee you. Because the amount of material and everything is not that large, as you can see with the size. So the reason I'm emphasizing is that if there is some interest in academic institutions, then you can have this wind tunnel. But somebody will actually do it for you for very low cost. So we have, this is a flow is coming in, it's also sonic flow. And then you have, and in this case you can see the, to create a converging, diverging nozzle kind of configuration, you can even put a bump. So, but it, the most important thing is that we have a microamp and we have a synthetic jet, and the idea was to evaluate the effect of both of them. And of course, the optimization was used, and which I am not going to discuss as a tool, where the size of the microamp and the parameters of the synthetic jet, basically there is one with the amplitude and a frequency, they were more or less decided that how good they should be. And this distance is very important, like 1.6 inch and so on. This is itself is small, but this is where the optimization comes in. You want to put it 2 inch away or half inch away and so on. And as I said, you have to take my word, but if you really genuinely interested, then I can send you, and just my email is there, and I will send you a PDF version of his thesis if you are interested in finding what the optimization is used. So a lot of this material actually which I am presenting, if you really are want to go deeper as a student research scholar, then I have all this thing in a PDF files from the students, and I can send it to you. Even for a backward facing step, you know, there is a lot of work that these students have. So this is a micro ramp, and I showed you this grid. So you have to have these dimensions, and this is the grid. And then of course, this is put on a flat plate. So the boundary layer is a flat plate, and the bump is only on the top, the convergent diverging. And you can create a structured grid, unstructured grid. But in general, we found after experimentation that because of the boundary layer effect, unstructured grid is not very good in accuracy, so you basically use a structured grid. The reason I brought it up here is that when you are doing research as a student, you know, you can explore all kind of possibilities if, you know, is required, and it's a good learning experience actually for a tool also. And so now what I'm showing you is that this is what we are interested in, that how the CFD works, and I showed you this slide before. So what you see here is there's a micro ramp, and eventually energization of the boundary layer takes place because of, so there are two separate vortices, which is a reverse delta wing at a subsonic flow, and then they come closer and merge, and downstream boundary layer gets energized, and then you know that it basically influences the skin friction. Now these are some blown up views. So this little vortex looks like this, the joint vortex looks like this. So these are nothing but blown up views which show the arrows, you know, how it looks like. Now remember that this is the CFD, so it has to be followed by you know, how good it is. And so now that is the same thing, you know, mark contours, pressure contours, they look the same. You can have vorticity contours also, they will also look the same. So you can plot whatever kind of contours you want. And all this software is actually built in Ansys Fluent if you want. And this was all done by Ansys Fluent, by the way. I don't know what version was this. I think it must be 11th or something. 11th. So now this is the synthetic jet. And in this case, to keep things less complicated, because in this case, you see, this is hybrid control. So the way synthetic jet works is that you have this micro ramp and you put the synthetic jet, so the little cavity is also a part of the synthetic jet, you know. So in order to avoid that little complication, I said, you know, just try boundary condition. So in this case, the cavity was not modeled. And as I told you, when you take my word for it, but if you don't, you can do it yourself, that except in the case when there is a touch vectoring, the boundary condition seems to work very well. And I will show so many cases as we move forward that it is almost, you can say, that 99% of the time you can just impose the boundary condition, except in few cases. But I think as a student, it's a good idea to try it. So now what you see here is that the characteristics that we have is that amplitude is 172 feet per second and frequency is 22 hertz. This is the highest candidate frequency that you can have in an actual actuator. But in the practice, you will never use that high. It's around up to 600 to 800 maximum. And so I'm showing you this, and then what you see here, that since it was a, you know, in a master's thesis, so I wanted the student to try everything. So that's why he has modeled it as a cavity also. But in general, it turns out that you don't have to model it. Okay. So, but it is worth trying this. So you have standard size that I showed you in the previous one, and this is integrated in the micro ramp, and so this is a very simple experiment. And I showed you some CFD solutions. And so now this is experimental CFD. And I really wanted to show you this tutorial, you know, because if you are going to do this, and then you will say, my goodness, you know, there's too much difference what is happening. But that is the way, reason is that this test that has been done, and this is, what does it show this here and what does it show here? Why this is different? Anybody? Just guess. It is the way you take the data and reduce the data. So the data here is averaged. And here data is time dependent, dynamic. And so you can see that how much difference the dynamic data is compared to the average data. So what happens is, for the purpose of flow control, you don't have to be here. This is good enough. So now we have two models which is built into the most of the course, and we will have actually a very good lecture on turbulence modeling later on, because I think that's a very, as a lecture, you know, you will really enjoy it. And so you can see that this is a CFD, and this is the SA model, and this is the SST. Now, here you see the CFD and UCFD. Now, why this is a little different and this is on the left and right? Again, what we did is to take this averaging, and this averaging, what we did is that here we try to include the averaging here, and here is done differently. So that was the creativity of his work, that we said that we will take the averaging here at the same time scale that was done in the experiment. And here we said that let the normal built-in Reynolds average, Navier-Stokes equation, which is a part of the Fluent, they do their own averaging. We cannot interfere that how the time scale is averaged in the built-in there. Okay, so that is where it has some kind of a turbulent fluctuations. So all these cases are run on both sides by using it by using a time-dependent solver. And so, if you remember in affluent, those of you know, so there is a time-dependent solver and there are a steady-state solver, and then you have in between, you know, these velocity coupling and simple and piezo and all that. But you can figure out which is the difference. But this slide is important to show that what is the difference in reducing the data from left to right, averaging, and also that averaging can be changed creatively even in the simulation. Okay, so it's a very instructive slide. Now again, you can see the velocity contour, the same problem. You see this. So if you want to come closer to this, you have to just close your eyes and run the fluent, and you see how closer this is with respect to this. But if you want to interfere with the same time scale that you have in the test, then you can get this kind of a behavior also. But then you have to, you know, do something more in do the averaging of the solution. So what this solution is actually the averaging of this solution. Okay, making sense? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, no, but that is not very difficult to develop. It is just you take the, if, let me tell you the most simple way to do it. So you have this solution here, and this is naturally averaged by the Navier-Stokes equations, and you put in SST model or SA model. Now you take this solution and average it on a longer scale. So you can do that your own. If you take this solution and average a longer scale, you can get this. But you can do that. You can go from here to here. That is one way to do it, but otherwise you can do it also by making some other changes. So the student, I wanted him to have a little more creativity, so he did it differently. But you can take this and do it. So all this, you know, but the reason he is good here is that you see the little peaks here, a peak here, but this area is completely not doing well. Okay, but I want you to have this flavor that what you can expect in a laboratory environment and what you can expect in the CFD environment and how they compare. And you can believe these slides because they have been done carefully actually. But if you only had this and you had this, you had, you know, this experiment and you had this, you know, I mean, and you show to somebody, they will say the CFD is no good. Okay. So these are some more details. Now those were synthetic jet, I think this is with the micro ramp. Okay? Same thing. Now you can see here the averaging of this and then averaging of this. So you have micro ramp, two vortices in the CFD. Now here, you know, I mean, I don't know the effect, we only ran the SA and SST model. But it's possible that if you have some other model, there will be some differences in the solution. And but I have a feeling that there will not be too much differences. Because if you look at it, SA is only one equation model. SST is a two equation model. And if you look at overall, they haven't changed too much, the overall solution. So, and I will show you when I talk about the turbulence modeling, we have our own model which we have developed, and they don't show too much difference. So, but bottom line is that that is the state of the art in CFD versus experiment. So there are some more data. So now this is a hybrid case. So previously I showed number one the synthetic jet only, then I showed you the synthetic jet plus, no, micro ramp separately, and this is a combo of the two. Okay. Now as I said, the optimization of it was done by a different algorithm that where to place them. It's a very actually, the experiment, you know, as I said, I haven't done too many experiments, but it was a really easy experiment to do. Because nowadays you can get a PIV kit also very cheap. So I don't think that it costs a lot of money and very small scale. So now this is some CFD stuff and these are the contours.
Experiment was done with PIV.
Yeah. Yeah, that's correct. Yeah. But you can use LDV or anything. Okay. The only thing is they don't interfere with the flow. So now this is the micro ramp only. This is a flow direction. These are all CFD results and shows that if you have a micro ramp, this little one here, flow is coming this way, then you know how the wake will be. And if you go the details that I showed you in the first slide, then you can see the voltage formation. But these are, you know, I mean, you cannot see it here, you know, it's too small a figure. Now if you go here, microwave plus synthetic jet, then you can see that there is a difference even at this small scale. So you have micro synthetic jet here, which actually is integrated with the microwave, no, not a microwave, but micro ramp, and you have a cavity accounted for in the calculation. So it's a really CFD wise quite a complicated calculation actually, because it's a three-dimensional calculation. But just to show you the difference, what you see between these two, without worrying too much detail, what do you see? What you see here is that the vertical structure is very complex here compared to this. And that is what happens, is that this is the one that is more effective in energizing the boundary layer. So the control authority that it has is a lot more than here. It is because you have two passive and active control. But if you want to explore this thing further, you could say, well, I can put two micro ramps, which I discussed before. I can have two synthetic jets. But here the purpose is to show this particular problem. Okay. So all these exploratory studies about the fundamental actuator mechanisms, both passive and active, you can explore it by using CFD or experiment, and you can learn a lot about the basic fundamental principles of how the flow control works. So that is the reason that I put this tutorial in. So now I want to show you another the actuator. It is different type of actuator, and if you remember that when we talked about the cavity oscillation control, right, then we had these micro jets coming out of the cavity. So then we wanted to see that how does the flow behaves in the micro jet. So this is a micro jet, and this you can have a elliptic cross section that is shown here, but it was a circular tube, and that is how, you know, most of the applications have, which I showed you yesterday in case of cavity oscillations. So this is a micro jet grid, and you see that this is a cutoff there. And so when you are doing this, you have to really use, you know, ICEM or Gambit or whatever you have, and then make sure that your grid is right, so that, because all these flows are have two features, you know, they are viscous and highly turbulent. So you have to make sure that your grid can basically capture these features, otherwise the results will not be good. So these are all the issues that are related to CFD. But what we are showing is basically what the CFD, how the CFD is applied. Now there are a lot of other subtleties instead of the grid, which, you know, also have to be accounted for, that is the boundary condition, the far field condition, and so on. So this is a study microjet. So interesting thing again, which I showed you in case of synthetic jet and microjet, you see that this is the flow is coming in from this tube, which is the microjet, and these are very small. I mean, they are the size of micro scale. So modeling them is very kind of. These are, I don't remember exactly, but it is of the micro scale in the sense that it will be of the order of about 10 to the power minus 3 meters. So 10 to the power minus 3 meters means around millimeter or so. Maybe even not more than, I would say, couple of millimeters. I have this information, but it's not there on the slide. But they are very, very small. So remember when I showed you the cavity case, that there were a row of micro jets and you can make them oscillatory also if you like, okay, or you can make them a study. So what we are wanted to see is that what is the mechanism that makes the flow that is coming out of this micro jet to modify the flow. And it turns out whether it's a synthetic jet or a, even I will talk about a sweeping jet later on, or it is any kind of a jet, one property they have is that they create a vortex structure. And that vortex structure creates a momentum, and the momentum is kind of a force that energizes the boundary layer, and then, so there is a various ways to do that. So you don't have to, you know, you can use synthetic jet, you can use micro jet, you can use some other oscillatory jet, and you can also, you know, use sweeping jets and so on. So these are basically, now this class of jets that I mentioned, and we will talk about that, they are classified as fluidic actuators, which we haven't used that word before, but later on when we proceed in the course. So plasma actuator is not a fluidic actuator, that is a non-fluidic actuator. There is no fluid involved, but in this case all the actuators are fluidic actuators. Fluidic means that the fluid is a mechanism by which the control is accomplished. So what it means is that whether it is a micro or actually even blowing an injection is a fluidic jet. So there is a classification in the literature which was not brought in before, and it will be brought in more succinctly later on, is called the fluidic actuator and non-fluidic actuator. So I think there is some lecture which completely covers only the fluidic actuator. But fluidic actuators are the most common used, because the issues are, as I told you, the body force issues and electrical connection issues are not there. So what we are showing here is the same mechanism. There is a jet coming in, and then this jet is the one that basically does the, but it is a different kind of jet. So it's a single jet, and it is, but this is the one that imparts momentum. This is just CFD calculation. Now this is a steady solution, but what I showed you yesterday in case of cavity, the jet was going with a frequency. So you can also have an oscillatory jet that has a frequency in it. So you can basically use the oscillation here, and then you will have a different kind of a behavior. So now the micro, I think I will just skip some of these slides, they are repetition. So this basically, but one of the things in terms of design, there is optimization which is important. In this case actually there is a combination of, there is a what is called a general design of experiment using the genetic algorithm plus neural nets together. So this is a kind of a, there are two things that we have to worry about. For the synthetic jet we use the neural nets, and for the distance between the micro jet and synthetic jet and the micro ramp, we use the genetic algorithm. So it was a combination of the work with a MATLAB and also with our own optimizer. So it was quite complicated, but the most important thing physically is that the height of the micro ramp should not exceed the log layer. So if you have a thickness of the boundary layer is delta, the rule of thumb is it should be less than delta over 3. Because once you are over delta over 3, it is certainly above the sub layer. It is certainly above the part of the buffer layer, let me put it this way. And that means a part of the log layer. Of course, if you have so thick that it becomes goes all the way to the boundary layer, then it will have a negative result, because it will create so much of separation in the back that it has a very negative effect. So this is a rule of the thumb, and that comes out of the optimization. So now this is synthetic jet, and this is actually real synthetic jet that was built. And so the velocity RMS means is a root mean square of the fluctuating velocity, which is sinusoidal. And the, I suggest, is a very high frequency of 2 2200 hertz, and this is the peak velocity which I showed you already, 172, and the size was sinusoidal. So this is a blowing phase and a suction phase. So, and then this is the hardware that was built. You can build the hardware. I have some other example. It is not a, you see, once you design a diaphragm, and I will show you, actually I have a actual hardware built for this one, which I will show you in a later. It is not that difficult. The only thing is that the outer structure, etc., you have to give it to, and there is a piezo diaphragm. So you have to have all that. But I have other slides I will show you. But what happens is that once you have all that, you don't have to do it, because we don't know how to do it. So we have experts in machine, we have machine lab, we have, you know, all these people whose job is full time to do this. So you tell them, this is my design and this is the material, and they will tell you, I will tell you that I need in a week. You will say, oh, it will take 2 weeks, that's it. But they will do a very good job. They are expert at it. And particularly in the university setting, if the people have been there for a long time, they know what you need. So they also, you can say that, and they actually sometimes they can give a very creative suggestion. Like you say, I need a frequency of say 2000. They will take care of everything, that by the time you have it, it is all tested and done. Because you cannot know everything actually. Our job is CFD, and we, our job is experiment. So you have to do that. Like a wind tunnel, which I showed you, my student didn't build the wind tunnel. He designed it and did the analysis and gave the guy to do it. And but if you have a bad work, where a bad person, bad not a person, but they are not very aptitude about this, then of course, you know, you have to figure out what to do. But this, all the manufacturing things, you know, somebody else did it. But the design was done by the student, okay? And this is the basically out of this thing, jet orifice, etc., was designed, and to achieve these kind of parameters, okay? And the reason I am emphasizing this experimental part is that I did, as I said, I have done only very few experiments, but it is not that difficult. It can be done in the lab, okay? And then you can do the CFD, and then you can compare the data. So the moral of this particular presentation is to emphasize the experiment also. So this is a hybrid device. I already talked about these parameters, you know. But the most important thing is that this height should be not very large. So there is a way to optimize this. But when another thing I want to caution it, keep the number of parameters in optimization as only those are very relevant. Just not for the heck of it, you know, you said I will put 20. Keep it 3 or 4. So in this case, the angle of the ramp and the thickness, those are the only two things that you need to optimize it. Don't take any more, okay? And then once you have done it, after that you know what is the required. So I gave you rule of thumb, that is what comes out. And not only we did it, later on all the papers that came out in the literature, they had the same rule of thumb. So which means that we verified what other people have done also. But we verified first, then they verified us. It doesn't matter who did what. So these are the things if you do the experiment. That, and now all these other dimensions are basically based on the size of your tunnel. So if the tunnel is very small, then again the boundary layer will be different, and so you have to account for that. Now all these distances, now when we optimize this, where the genetic algorithm was used, the distance between the this synthetic jet and the micro ramp. Now as I said, that originally when the student did this, he used the cavity, but later on we found that cavity is not required. So there is no point in having a cavity to make life more difficult. So all these things, they come out. But as a student, I would say that it is all very good to learn, you know, how the grade and all the other machinery works. So now this is the total computational domain. So this is the tunnel, and if you push the flow, then of course it will look like this. Of course, dpdx, you know, is have to be greater than 0, as I told you yesterday. If it is adverse pressure gradient, then you are in trouble, and which is verified, you know, with these contours. And this is the plan view. And so if you look at it, here is the micro ramp, and it is synthetic jet, and both of them are in this hump area. Okay, and so this is a very simple schematic, and as you can see, these dimensions are very small. So it was a small tunnel, and as a matter of fact, that tunnel is still lying around. The student is gone 5 years ago, and nobody is doing experiment anymore. But it's such a small occupancy of the area in the lab that nobody has bothered us, you know, to remove it. So if anybody wants to come and do it, you know, there is available for you. We can ship it to you actually, but the cost of shipping is a lot more than the you built it yourself. You know, the cost of shipping has become so bad. There was about I would say icing tunnel that Boeing had, which was about $30 to $40 million, because you know, you want to make sure that when the aircraft is flying under cold conditions, the ice, if it is deposited, it can cause an accident because the whole profile changes. So that is why you have to de-ice the plane under cold environment. And they want to get rid of it. Nobody is a taker. Nobody wants to take it. Because you have to disassemble it, ship it, deassembling itself is $10 million. And ship it, and then the person who takes it, he has to assemble it. And whenever you take something and break it up, you can never put it together correctly. So he knows that. He has done this kind of thing. So what I'm just giving you these little bit of stories, you know, about, you know, how these experiments work. But this is very simple. Okay, so now this is a computational mesh I showed you before. It's, you know, quite, again, you have to know how to put the grid, how to structure versus unstructured, you know, you have to make all these decisions. So in this case, the surface mesh was like 260,000, and I think the overall grid was of several million points to basically take care of this. And as I told you before, the structured grid is very necessary in the viscous region. After other ones, you can use the unstructured grid. Okay. Now, it turned out that this is the one example in which we had to combine the Reynolds average with the large energy simulation. So the simulation became also later on the hybrid simulation, because when the data was compared, we could not figure out that why there is so much discrepancy. So we tried all kind of turbulence model, it won't work. So eventually it was found that turbulence model is the culprit. So then it was became a hybrid model, using part of it as a Ramesh model and the part of it as a large energy simulation. So that is what it in here. You see this. You can see this guy, he did so much work for a master's thesis, and that's why he was hired later on at Boeing, and now he is still there. So this is the structured gate and combination of unstructured gate for the synthetic jet, and then downstream, you know, it also has a combination of Reynolds average plus LES and all these other stuff that I have already mentioned, that ICEM has been used. I don't know whether you people have it here. Original was Gambit. So, but now ICEM is there in all the fluents, like versions, you know, which have come 12 or 13 or 15. And then the total grid that has been there, which is shown here, has about 6.8 million cells. And there are about 250,000 were on the micro ramp alone. And then, of course, the Y plus has to be less than 1. You know, for the solution to be accurate for the Ramesh simulation. And so now this is a fluent and hybrid modeling, as I said, with Ramesh and LES. And then this is what is called DES. So when I talked about the turbulence modeling, I will go over in very great depth about detached energy simulation and other concepts. Now, hardware, of course, is a supercomputer because too many grid points, and these are the flow conditions of the tunnel. So the Reynolds number is turbulent, which is about 2.9 million per foot. Okay, so those are some tunnel data, and the data was collected in the throat region and also in the far field. And of course, this was verified, this area, by the CFD, which was RANS plus the simple data. So now this is the far field. I showed you these two locations, throat, center of the throat, and far field. Because here nothing is happening. Why not is happening? There is no control. So the control is in here. The ramp is here, synthetic jet is here. So why worry about this? And the upstream effect is very small, hardly nothing. So you don't have to worry about it, it is very benign flow. And then of course downstream is required, that is where the control is, effect of the control is. So these have to be selected, you know, carefully, so that your data collection and your comparison is very effective. So there is no need to do data collection here, you are wasting time. So now it is showing the near field and it is showing the far field, and what is the change. So now far field boundary layer is thicker and less full, and here the upstream boundary layer. Okay. So now this slide has some very fundamental information here. If you have taken a basic course in fluid mechanics, this has two statements here. One is far field boundary condition, which is this, is thicker and less full. So this is the delta is 0.36 inch and is 0.25 inch. It's by measurements actually, and you can show that roughly you get the same thing by CFD, not quite, but same thing. Now this is the boundary layer profile. So, and it says far field baseline shape factor is 1.48. So anybody knows the definition of a shape factor? If you have taken a course in, yes sir, very good, you get a dollar. Not many people remember it. This is a beautiful answer. So now, given that statement, is the shape factor less is better or shape factor more is better? Tell me, another dollar. Okay, anybody else? No, you said a statement, I am saying anybody else has an answer. You see, he gave a very good answer. The delta star over theta is the shape factor, right? So delta star is the displacement thickness and the theta is the momentum thickness. So it's a little bit not that easy to give the right answer. But just think about it, that what should, and look at the profile also if you like to look at it. So if the control has worked and you have measured the profile and you have calculated it by CFD, which is better, less or more? Okay. You tell me, you are a smart guy there. You are an undergraduate, right? Yeah, they are always smart. So what's your name? Okay, wonderful. So can you guess? So shape factor should be smaller for the boundary layer to be more effective. And so that is counterintuitive actually. Okay. But if you do the calculation, you will find that is indeed the case. But here you see that the delta has become thicker. Okay. So if you think about that, and you have 1 minus u over u infinity integral from 0 to delta, and delta is thicker, it looks like it should be larger. Then momentum thickness you don't know, right? So that becomes u over u infinity times 1 minus u over u infinity times dy 0 to delta. So why is happening to the momentum thickness? So the velocity plays a very important role in that, and while the delta is slightly higher, okay? So it turns out that you have to have a shape factor. In this case, shape factor is 1.48, and this is experimental, and CFD is about the same. So now micro ramp effect, again we have shown these results about 2 vortices and which convect downstream because of the flow. So this is all CFD actually. And this is a micro ramp effect in the near field and in the far field. And so it again, all these things you can do by CFD, all these beautiful color, you know, plots, how the vortex looks like. So there is not much. So but the thing is that the effect of upwash and downwash and vortex formation you can see in the near field. And what you see here is that effect of control, that is what qualitatively is a good answer, a good thing to look. So you look at in the near field means in the throat region. Throat region means that you are very close to the micro ramp and the synthetic jet, right? So you see the vortex. Now you see here, as you go slightly far field, where the control has now taken action because of the micro ramp as well as the synthetic jet. So now you can see that this vortex has more energy and momentum to impart into the flow. So it basically qualitatively is doing the what we are supposed to have it do. Okay. Now we are not talking about how much control authority will have, how much a reduction in the drag will have, but it will have some. And that a measure of that, there are various other measures, but the simplest and easiest measure is that you measure the velocity profile by PIV or calculate it by CFD, and it is very easy to calculate the shape factor, and you can say that this is my fish shape factor, and so it worked or it didn't work. So that is a very simple single measure to evaluate the effectiveness of the control. Now whether that is enough or not, that is a separate question. So that is where, you know, your optimization, your trying this, trying that, all come into play. But the whole thing is working as a demonstration and satisfying yourself that you can do the experiment and you can do the CFD. Okay. So now you can do all kind of these other things that is there. So you see that this is an interesting thing. That was micro ramp alone. So this is a shape factor due to the baseline flow field, okay, for 1.48. What is this here? 1.43, okay. So what is better? 1.43 is better, but I want to caution you, if you did not design the micro ramp properly, you have a very thick micro ramp which goes all the way to the wake region of the boundary layer, covers all the log region. It may have adverse effect. It may actually totally destroy the flow control concept. So I am only showing you the good results actually. But the student, I asked him, I said, hey, you know, to try it, see what happens. And it turns out it can destroy the whole thing. Okay. So as because all of you are students, research scholars, I would say that once you have got a good feel about CFD, it doesn't take too long to try other things. So that's what I was telling this Shubham, you know, that you should try on backward facing step, everything that you can, once you have done the fundamental basic result and validated. Always remember validation. And the third one, right. So this is the whole summary, you know, still not good. So there is a 3.4% decrease by a single micro ramp. It's not bad actually. 3.4% is not bad, which means that you have reduced the skin friction, not exactly the same, but about the same. Okay. So now next is the synthetic jet effect. And again, you know, we will not go into these details. You know what the parameters are, and these are zero net mass flux and all that. And these are some other details. But the important thing here is that this is important. Solution is time averaged over 5 jet cycles. Okay. Otherwise, you know, it's very difficult to analyze the solution. And even the experiment is time averaged, but otherwise the fluctuation that are measured, you know, is very difficult to analyze and compare with the CFD. The synthetic jet alone is 1.43. All right. So, I mean, it's too difficult, too much to remember, you know. How much was the original without any control? How much was the shape factor? I don't remember, actually. I have to go back. 1.48. You guys remember it, actually. That's very good. So, there was 1.43 with ramp alone. This is 1.43 with synthetic jet alone. Right? It's about the same. Take a little bit error here and there. So, it's again 3.4% less. So, this is the summary. So, now comes the last one. Whether two of them together, okay, can do together. All right. So just imagine, you know, you have a guy who doesn't want to run and you are running, what is going to happen? Right? You don't know unless, you know, you see what happens. You have a hare and a tortoise. But it may turn out the tortoise may win the race. Okay? Or if they are together, of course, if that is what I am showing here. So this is micro ramp and then this is the hybrid and this is the one that the ramp trajectory, and this is, I think, the hybrid co-trajectory. And now, what is the shape factor of the combined one? Not much. 4.3 and 1.429 is not something that you get excited, you know, nothing. So, what it shows is that hybrid didn't do much. So, micro ramp alone we did it. And synthetic jet alone did it. So, if I give you the task to decide, and I am not a single answer, and you have to design a control for a simple flat plate to reduce the skin friction or drag, okay? What is your, everybody can have an opinion, okay? All right? So, there. The lady from my town, right, Sonia, you know, what is your answer? Which one you would like? You can like micro ramp, or you can like synthetic jet, or you... Okay. Okay. So, I don't know which town you are. The other lady, Nisha, you know, what is your answer? Okay, all right. And then thirdly also, we have three cases, hybrid, synthetic. So Manjari, what is your answer? Micro ramp. So micro ramp wins by 2-1. And micro ramp, you know, is less costly and simply to implement. And same answer, the same answer, right? And the amount of money required is less. It doesn't mean that your answer is bad, actually. The moral of the story is that when you are trying to do things from scratch, you have to do this. But also there is other moral of the story is that what I am telling you, you can believe it, you know, little bit, but don't believe it 100%. It is quite possible that the experiment that we did may have some error. It's possible that the CFD that we did is an error. But if there are two or three people from different schools have repeated and got the same result, then I think you have to move on. I will not say that unnecessarily then you again repeat this thing. But if only one person has done, it is important to repeat it. Because you don't know. There is always a possibility that there could be. But I am telling you that this is in general a good result. Okay? But it has been shown to work only like this case clearly. I will show you later on a case in which again we worked with Boeing that had a curved S duct, it is called, which is used very much in the fighter aircraft and in a propulsion system. And that's where the micro ramp seemed to do well. Synthetic jet did not do again well. But the best thing that did was the vanes. So I am going to talk about later. But in general, you know, as I was telling you, the synthetic jet, which has been hyped up so much, thousands of papers have been written, and I think that it has not borne out that it is as good. First of all, it doesn't have that much control authority. The other thing is the integration, the building, the weight, designing, they all add to the cost. So as you saw that even designing that little synthetic jet, it was a costly affair. Not in terms of the time of the individual, the material, but who built it, they were expensive. Micro ramp, it is easy, you know, just stick it in. But it is not that simply stick it in. You have to design the micro ramp properly. You have to put it in the right place. Okay? So all these things are a part of research, part of scientific investigation to do it right. Okay? So this is the, again, as I said, factor should be. Yeah. Alright, so this is the overall effectiveness. So your baseline, which is shown here, then you have average, you have ramp only, and then you have ramp only average, and then so these are the fluctuating ones and these are the average ones, and then the hybrid and the hybrid average. So you can see this chart that basically ramp is as good as the hybrid. And then this is the spanwise shape factor distribution downstream of the throat, and that is what we are interested in. Okay. So this is the average H. So where are we? We are 1.429 or something. So we are around somewhere here. So this is the conclusion, which you already know. All right. So let us spend a few minutes because this is a good tutorial, because it brings the active, the passive, and the hybrid for a very simple configuration of a flat plate. It includes the experiment, and it is all done by one group. It is not a diverse group, and it was done in a low cost affair, and all the implementation was done extremely carefully. And there are some fundamental ideas that I have brought in, that one of the criteria of reducing the skin friction, if you don't have a direct measurement of the shear stress. Nowadays there are sensors that can measure the shear stress for you. Then shape factor is one of the good ones. You have to go through the shape factor. You can just take the velocity profile, calculate the gradient, and get the shear stress, and you can get the answer. In case of experiment, it is very hard. The experiment to go, even with a PAV very close to the surface, you can miss the exact surface. And there is a lot of gradient there. So you need actually for an accurate measurement of the skin friction, you need a shear stress sensor. But delta star over theta is a good measure, and you can see that the result that I've shown you, if you do all that, you can make some decision. For, and I'm again cautioning you, it doesn't work for every case. There may be all the sometimes a case that the results are very different than what I'm showing you. But at least I've shown you a way to do research and way to evaluate research and keep it as simple as you can, the low cost outcome which can be implemented in an environment like here. Okay, so I think we can close this. If you have any questions, let me know right now, or you can ask again tomorrow, you know, in first 10 minutes or so. Okay, yes sir. The once, as I told you, CFD, you must do the validation. Now once you have done the validation and you have a confidence, so now we have made a lot of conclusions out of this result. So now what you can do is you say that I have a CFD tool, I know what is the grid, I know what is the boundary condition, I know what is the size of the ramp, then you can use it. Because then you can say, let me try, instead of delta by 3 thickness, let me try delta by 4. Or you can say, let me have a synthetic jet of different frequency. Because then I think your level of confidence goes up, because you have already a validated tool. But if you did not have any experiment, you have no validation, then I think that I will be hesitant actually. Because as I told you, the number of grid points is 6.9 million. So you can get this answer very quickly for 200,000 points. But that answer may not be worthwhile, because it may be by error by 15%, 20%. So what is the requirement for the grid? What is the requirement for the boundary condition? And also, you know, you learn a lot, as I told you, do get the right answer with least amount of work. That should be your motto, all right? So which means only you measure at the throat and downstream. You don't want to really measure everywhere, and you really don't want to calculate everywhere. No, you have to calculate, but analyze the data everywhere. So always use the CFD after validation. And then the use of CFD is to expand the parametric space. Otherwise, you know, there is no point if you are going to do all the experiment all the time. So you can expand the parametric space and turn around all the solutions in a short time. Okay. Any other question?
But sir, it is not a question, it is a very mature idea to your discussion. Like, can we have this kind of arrangement, a part of exhaust of, say, plane, if it could be incorporated through micro ramp or somewhat synthetic jet with micro ramp to be created at the boundary, like through pipe, a small part of exhaust, because it will give a very good governing also. A small pipe through the surface of plane that goes away, and we are governing it through micro ram and other, and we are having small holes or such things by which this jet can go out. Because the amount of heat that is being required to induce in the boundary layer would be we can manipulate that by governing the flow amount of heat. So it is just a rough idea, but I think because it's a very low cost thing, requires no energy and could manipulate the boundary layer.
Okay, as I have been telling you, what exactly you are trying to accomplish? That is the number one thing. I mean, this was a fundamental study, okay? But we accomplished something, okay? Now, the more important point is that how are you going to accomplish? So you said something which I really did not quite understand. You said there is an exhaust coming out of the engine nozzle,
yeah.
And you take at the entrance at the exit of the nozzle,
yeah.
And you are going to have a pipe. Where? How are you going to create a pipe there? You know how the pipe will be used, and then you are taking it up there.
So it's kind of very high velocity during exhaust, and suppose.
Friction of drag of what? No, you see, let me rephrase it for you. You have exhaust. I don't care how high velocity it is. I don't care how high temperature it is. That is a given. It has high temperature, it has high velocity, and the way combustion might have taken place, it may have all kind of gases, okay? And if it is goes far enough, it will mix with the ambient air. It will create a bigger area of plume, and then depending on the orientation of the aeroplane, it may go up or down. All right. What I am trying to understand is, what are you trying to accomplish there? You are saying you can somehow take this concept, which means that you are talking about some micro ramp you are thinking about, you are thinking about a synthetic jet. Where are you going to put it, and what is the goal? What are you trying to do? It has nothing to do with drag reduction, it has nothing to do with separation, right?
By, say, active flow control, by introducing jet, we are inducing certain movements
of the air. No, first of all, I don't know how are you going to integrate this. You know, exhaust is coming, where are you going to put the synthetic jet? Tell me. I mean, you are not going to put the synthetic jet in a thin air, right? And then you are saying there is some pipe. How are you going to integrate the pipe?
Think over the idea.
You know, I had a very, actually this is a true story. I mean, it is not a far-fetched thing. And this lady, whom I respect a lot, she is quite old lady actually, and very good person, and we had a discussion, you know. She knows I am aeronautical scientist, and she said, you know, all these planes keep crashing, why don't they put a rope and hang it? You know, I mean, it's a good answer, right? If there is a way that you can anchor that rope into the sky, it will be a good thing, right? Okay, so that's a good area to research. Think about it. I can tell you a lot of stories, you know, which are really very interesting actually. So, you know, we can have a beer and discuss them. Okay, any other question? Yeah. You see, I repeat it so many times. I said in this case micro ramp is as competitive as the hybrid, right? But I always cautioned you that it is not the final answer. It is something we came with this solution. But I will show you that for a S duct, if you recall, this is not the solution so far. So there is no single solution which we know today that works. At least in AFC. AFC doesn't work. But we have enough information that we know what might work or what might not work. There is no single solution at this point. You know, like for example, if you go back to Turbin's research at the age of Prandtl in 1905 or 1910, the Prandtl mixing line theory is still powerful. But now we know what works in modeling and it still is not done. What I am telling you is micro ramp, but sometimes doesn't work. Synthetic jet works, sometimes not. After 20 years of research in synthetic jet, and I am telling you, okay, but if you tell to Harry Glaser, he will kill me. He has made a lot of money out of that. If my judgment is that where you read the real control authority, you see, these are little bit of problems that I am showing you, which are experimental. Just like bleed and injection, you know, it has been working for 60 years or 80 years. In actual car or in actual aeroplane, it's not working because the control authority is not there. And if you put too many of them to create a control authority, it's too heavy. Everything is gone. So it is a holistic thing that you have to look at. So my conclusion is that when Boeing and Airbus have concluded, and I was involved in a little bit way, that it is not working. But there are so many papers, I mean hundreds and hundreds, maybe thousands of papers which show it is working. And people are still pumping out papers. There is nothing wrong with that. But I am saying that how much control authority you need is the most important factor. So there is not a single solution. But if you have all this knowledge, there is a micro ramp, there is a, you know, whatever the names are, you know, other devices, you know, vortex generator, etc. And in some cases, vanes, guide vanes. Once we have all this picture, what works, what doesn't work, so then I think, like for example, you know, I asked the three ladies, you know, for three answers. It was clear that the micro ramp is a good answer, right? From this presentation. But I will be hesitant to say that this is the answer for everything. We are not there yet. We are not enough advanced in AFC that we know the answer. So that is why, remember that the last presentation there was a slide. It says that it's still an empirical science that we are still trying to do. So maybe in another 15-20 years we may have a better answer, but we are learning a lot. Like when I remember that when Smith and Glaser wrote their paper, and Harry Glaser, you know, he all these people, you know, are good friends of mine, and people thought that it's wonderful, everything is done. But it turned out that people kept on working and working, and they find it's not works. Okay. But it doesn't mean that it doesn't work always, you know. In laboratory it works beautifully. In a small controller it works beautifully. But then, you know, there was another concept in a case of supersonic flow that people come up with, which are called a combustion driven jets. So what happens is that you have a jet and you have a piston, and underneath the piston you burn the fuel, and you create a combustion with a very high velocity, so you have more control authority. And it seemed to show a more control authority means more effect, but that's a very dangerous thing to do. Okay, how are you going to deal? It is difficult to integrate a simple jet into a car or a aeroplane. Can we imagine that integrating a combustion driven jet under the wing? I will never fly in that aeroplane. It is impossible. So you can have a lot of ideas, but many of them are totally impractical. But as an academic, there is one advantage that you can explore all the impractical ideas and still make a living. All right, that's what I do. Okay. Any other question? Very good questions actually, very relevant. Okay, so we are at 7:30. So I was thinking, you know, that you should, because we are a little behind that the lecture 3, that you should maybe, you know, try to spend some time and we can go it faster, because from now on you see that the in the basic theory of those lectures, I think the most important will be terminus modeling, and most of them are some new introduction of ideas a little bit, but the some tutorials are, I think, are going to be more useful, because they will bring out the way we have bring out today, that what are the real fundamental issues. So there is no really demarcation line. So I think that that's where, you know, we'll start, you know, tomorrow. But tomorrow when we start at 3:30, please come prepared with your questions, you know, because as I said, all the questions of every student is a great question. The only question that I will criticize is from Dr. Jain. Okay.
So let us